欢迎收看今天的汉天新闻，我是赵子彤。首先来看国际方面的消息，美国众议院总统弹劾调查12月4日进入司法委员会的新阶段。在当天的公开听证会上，民主党、共和党双方发生激烈争执，为了是否应该弹劾川普总统进行唇枪舌剑的火爆交锋。另外，在场的三位宪法学者认为，川普寻求外国干预美国选举已构成可弹劾他的罪行，但第四位作证的宪法学者表示强烈异议，坚称川普必须犯下重大罪行和行为不端才能被加以弹劾，但目前的证据仍然极其不足。
The hearing is adjourned. The House Judiciary Committee wrapped up a day of marathon testimony. Four expert witnesses, all constitutional scholars, appeared before the committee to outline what constitutes an impeachable offense.
That it wasn't just an abuse of power because the president was serving his own personal interests, but also an abuse of power insofar as the president was putting American national security interests behind his own personal interests.
Three witnesses said President Trump's actions were impeachable. One disagreed.
I believe this impeachment not only fails to satisfy the standard of past impeachments, but would create a dangerous precedent for future impeachments.
But one comment sparked immediate backlash.
Contrary to what President Trump has said, Article 2 does not give him the power to do anything he wants. The Constitution says there can be no titles of nobility. So while the president can name his son Barron, he can't make him a Barron.
That when you invoke the president's son's name here, when you try to make a little joke out of referencing Barron Trump, that does not lend credibility to your argument. It makes you look mean.
First Lady Melania Trump condemned the remark, tweeting in part that Carlin, quote, should be very ashamed of your very angry and obviously biased public pandering. Carlin went on to apologize for the statement.
It was wrong of me to do that. I wish the president would apologize, obviously, for the things that he's done that's wrong, but I do regret having said that.
I'm Meredith Wood reporting.
美国国会众议院议长南希·佩洛西12月5日在发言中称，美国总统川普任内滥用职权，要求民主党领导的司法委员会推进川普弹劾条款。事实上，从弹劾程序讨论开启到现在，仅仅过去十个星期，众议院的效率已经显得很高，目前把弹劾推进到了一个重要的节点上。现在，一些法律方面的专家和反对人士开始质疑对于美国政坛如此重大的事件，这样的推进速度是否显得轻率。
Democrats are measuring just how quickly they want to expedite the impeachment process.
We will receive the report next week from the Intelligence Committee, so a presentation will be made to the Judiciary Committee, and then we have to make a decision.
A full vote on the House floor on impeachment could come before Christmas. But House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, who will ultimately decide Democrats' final timeline, is staying quiet. Multiple sources tell CNN she's meeting privately with her party members,asking if they're ready to impeach President Trump. House Democrats are looking at what potential articles of impeachment could be, including abuse of power and bribery, obstruction of justice, and obstruction of Congress.
We're not rushing it. We're at day 71 right now, and we've had extensive hearings, extensive witness transcripts, and then the most damning evidence came out first.
Republican allies of the president hammering the issue of speed at Wednesday's hearing.
The clock and the calendar are what's driving impeachment, not the facts.
Judiciary Chairman Jerry Nadler stressing they had no choice.
If we do not act to hold him in check now, President Trump will almost certainly try again to solicit interference in the election for his personal political gain.
As House Democrats weigh the next steps towards impeachment, the White House is preparing for the likely Senate trial.White House counsel Pat Cipollone meeting with Republican senators, telling them they're ready to play defense, without getting into details of a strategy, one senator tells CNN. But on Capitol Hill, four constitutional scholars testified about impeachable conduct.
If what we're talking about is not impeachable, then nothing is impeachable.
All three of the Democrats' witnesses saying Trump's efforts to pressure Ukraine into investigating his political rivals amounts to impeachable behavior.
Did President Trump commit the impeachable high crime and misdemeanor of abuse of power?
We three are unanimous.
The Republicans' witness, Jonathan Turley, says it's premature to move forward.
I'm concerned about lowering impeachment standards to fit a paucity of evidence and an abundance of anger.
北大西洋公约组织峰会在英国伦敦闭幕。会议结束后，北约领导人参加大合影。虽然这次北约峰会面临众多困难，成员国之间矛盾重重，但依然最终达成了一份结束性声明。声明中，盟友们重申了相互支持的立场，并指出中国是新的挑战，俄罗斯仍然是潜在的风险。
Day two of the NATO gathering brought the usual pledges of unity and collective support that you'd expect from a transatlantic alliance that now has 29 members and has brought peace and stability to around about a billion people across the globe these days. However, behind the scenes, while the cracks quickly began to show, with bad temper and discord very much being recorded at various bilaterals and press conferences and also behind the scenes at this event in Buckingham Palace that took place on Tuesday evening when the Queen hosted a reception for world leaders. Four of those world leaders, including the leader of Canada, the UK, France and also the Netherlands, were overheard discussing the US president, the biggest guest of all, at this summit behind his back. Well, that in turn prompted President Trump to call, in particular, the Prime Minister of Canada, Justin Trudeau, two-faced.
Well, he's two-faced.
Do you think that Germany is too naive?
And honestly, with Trudeau, he's a nice guy. I find him to be a very nice guy. But, you know, the truth is that I called him out on the fact that he's not paying 2%, and I guess he's not very happy about it. I mean, you were there, a couple of you were there, and he's not paying 2%, and he should be paying 2%. It's Canada, they have money, and they should be paying 2%. So I called him out on that, and I'm sure he wasn't happy about it, but that's the way it is. Look, I'm representing the U.S., and he should be paying more than he's paying, and he understands it. So I can imagine he's not that happy, but that's the way it is.
The president decided to leave early and then cancelled a press conference that had originally been planned. Now, aside from these strained interpersonal relationships that also saw Presidents Trump and Macron spar after a bilateral that they had, there are some really serious issues that NATO has to contend with. In fact, it is the likes of President Trump and President Macron who've sort of set the stage for this after the US president a few years ago called NATO obsolete and criticized other members for not contributing their fair share in defense spending. More recently, President Macron went into this summit calling the alliance brain dead. They have various issues to contend with over the next few years, some of which were discussed at this summit, including the likes of Russia, but also whether or not terrorism should play a bigger part in some of the challenges that they have to consider, things like cybercrime and so on and so forth. One of the biggest challenges for NATO actually comes from within its own ranks, and that is Turkey, after this country recently controversially decided to purchase a missile defense system from Russia, one of the big original foes of NATO when it was born during the height of the Cold War. Turkey's leader Recep Tayyip Erdogan has also taken time to lobby other world leaders to try and gain support for his fight against Kurdish groups in Syria, ones that he deems to be terrorists and other NATO members have seen as allies. Either way, this was supposed to be a celebration of unity and what NATO had achieved over the last 70 years. Instead, it appears as though this bloc is having something of a three-quarter life crisis these days. Nina Dos Santos, CNN, London.
美国总统川普于12月3日在伦敦向记者表示，虽然我同朝鲜最高领导人金正恩建立了良好的关系，我喜欢他，他也喜欢我，我们不希望动用武力，但如果有必要，我们将不得不这样做。对此，朝鲜罕见地迅速做出回应。朝鲜方面警告称，使用本国的武力并不仅仅是美国的特权。金正恩表示，美国想要什么样的圣诞礼物要自己选。目前，朝美双方来之不易的缓和局势再次重回紧张态势。
North Korea's diplomatic thaw looking more like a deep freeze. New images show Kim Jong-un riding a white horse, touring snow-covered battle sites on Mount Paektu, his second visit to the sacred mountain in 2 months.
Our general is really a person who heaven sent to us.
2 years ago, I visited Mount Paektu. North Koreans believe Kim's father was born here. Kim has a track record of visiting the sacred site before making big announcements.
Whenever he goes up to this Mount Paektu, he does something, to give a shock to the rest of the world.
The shock of short-range missile launches is wearing off. Last week, the 13th weapons test this year, a year that began with diplomatic disappointment, the collapse of summit talks in Vietnam.
We've seen more than a dozen launches since the failed Hanoi summit. Why do you think Kim keeps doing this?
He thinks that he can pressure the U.S. a little bit by little bit, escalating on this front.
Those escalations don't seem to faze U.S. President Donald Trump.
Like sending rockets up, doesn't he? That's why I call him Rocket Man. I like him, he likes me.
On Tuesday, Trump expressed confidence in diplomacy. Time to strike a deal may be running out. North Korea gave the U.S. an ultimatum, a breakthrough by the end of the year. That's less than a month away. Their latest cryptic warning came just this week. It says it's entirely up to the U.S. what Christmas gift it will select.
They're certainly going to make some sort of political statement, around Christmas.
Even President Trump's point man on North Korea admits the new year.
They will be met with fire and fury.
Could revive old tensions.
I can imagine that we could see a possibility of going back to some of the more provocative steps that preceded the start of this diplomacy to begin with.
Provocative steps that could include nuclear and long-range missile testing. President Trump's three face-to-face meetings with Kim failed to resolve the most sensitive issue, sanctions. This U.S. computer expert is accused of traveling to Pyongyang, advising North Koreans how to avoid sanctions using cryptocurrency. That's a violation of U.S. law. Virgil Griffith's lawyer disputes the allegations and says his client looks forward to his day in court. Kim is urging North Koreans to build a self-reliant economy, immune from sanctions. Everyone who lives in this new town helped build it. North Koreans are being told to brace themselves for what could be a long standoff. Will Ripley, CNN.
当地时间周三，美国夏威夷珍珠港海军基地发生枪击案件。当天下午2点左右，一名现役美国海军水手突然举枪袭击了其他三名来自国防部的平民员工，之后开枪自尽。基地一度因枪击案件封锁，被袭击者其中两人死亡，一人受伤。目前情况已经稳定。目前案件的具体细节还在调查之中。 白宫针对此事发表声明，表示将密切监督调查发展。
Tragedy at Joint Base Pearl Harbor Hickam in Honolulu Wednesday afternoon.
I heard loud pops, and I kind of recognized that as gunshots, and immediately I looked out the window, saw three people on the ground.
Officials say a U.S. sailor opened fire, wounding three civilian employees. Two of the victims are confirmed dead, the third taken to the hospital and said to be in stable condition.
Obviously, our thoughts are with the families of the victims and everyone involved.
The sailor, a male who was assigned to the USS Columbia, then took his own life. This shooting happened 3 days before the 78th anniversary of the Pearl Harbor attack.
The role that the shipyard played in World War II is pretty legendary, and the shipyard is well known for the amazing work they did then and the amazing work they continue to do. So this is certainly a tragedy for everyone here.
The base was on lockdown for about 3 hours before being reopened.
What's going through your mind right now?
Just really irritated.
An investigation is ongoing. No word yet on a possible motive. I'm John Lawrence reporting.
休息一下，马上回来。